Instamatic. Where does it say? Oh, yeah, Instamatic. Super 8. Is it Super 8? Maybe just an 8. Movie camera. It was my dad's. I pulled it down off of its spot on the shelf there, the sort of the museum, to remind me and you that technology changes. And the time that we transition from this to the cameras that I'm shooting this program on, there's one back there. It's a light in the way. You can't see the camera. Oh, well. Single sideband has still been the predominant mode in ham radio. And all that time, this was in the 50s, maybe the 60s. Ham, I hear a cat. Ham Radio Now, episode 297. This is from the ARRL and TAPR 2016 Digital Communications Conference, St. Petersburg, Florida, last September. New Frontiers in Wireless. Going to be presented by Brennan Price, N4QX. At the time, Brennan was the Chief Technology Officer for the ARRL. He is currently a Senior Principal Engineer for EchoStar Corporation, and I'll tell you a little bit more about that in a minute. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. Ham Radio Now. There's a cat. She may come over here. Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. Normally it's the Kickstarter, but we'll start with Arvin back there, hamradionow.tv. If you didn't get in on the Kickstarter or you want to help us out financially, stop by hamradionow.tv and you can help out. That's what we look like there. From the Kickstarter, we're also brought to you by TAPR. TAPR is the sponsor of the Digital Communications Conference, of course. Anything that has anything to do with digital, either modes or equipment, software, stuff like that. TAPR does that. And they would love to have you as a member. Next time you get a chance to see them will be at the Dayton Hamvention. So stop by there. They really got to update the website. It's still showing 2016. But they'll have a big booth. And we are also brought to you as part of the Kickstarter by this guy, Chud, from Node Systems Limited. Chud's call signs are M1PUP and 2E1BXW. Chud is in London, UK, based Worldwide Projects, providing technical project management, design and build, in telecommunication systems, security systems, SCADA, command and control systems, mainly in the police, ambulance, and retail sector. Contact Chud by email at Chud, C-H-U-D, at nodesystems.co.uk, or you can follow him on Twitter. This is his Twitter page, at Node Systems. And Chud, this will be the last time we say hi to you. Thank you very much for jumping in on the Kickstarter and helping us out. And finally, it's the kids. What am I going to do here with the kid thing? I am going to take you back to the Phasing Line podcast. Marty and Sterling, they've got their own website now, phasinglinepodcast.com. And Sterling did a talk, it's not the most recent episode, it's one back. It's this one here, the Phasing Line Bonus, Amateur Radio's Next Generation. By Sterling. He gave that talk at the Winterfest, which is a ham fest in the St. Louis area. And let's see. I guess this is the specific talk that he gave. It's just audio. They don't have. He says he's going to have a video on YouTube. That didn't work out. He's got to update his website, too. That didn't work out, so it's just audio. But I would recommend that you listen to it. And so why Sterling again? Well, it's because we have to keep looking for ideas on how to create the next generation of hams. What we're doing now isn't working well enough. I'm not going to say it's not working at all. Got a cat climbing up here. She'll be up here in a minute. I'm not saying it's not working at all. It's just not working well enough to get that replacement generation or two. Sterling is asking more questions than he can answer. but there aren't enough other hams even thinking about the questions. So I recommend listening to as many of these things as possible. Yeah. See, I go to reach for her and she runs away, but then she starts pawing at my leg. I recommend, you know, just kind of steeping yourself, paying attention to the things that are really working and or the people that are really talking about this idea. Not the folks that just, you know, give lip service to the idea that we got to have more kids, but folks that are really trying to figure out what to do about it. And there's a couple of spots that I want to point out in specific that Sterling is leading you to on this website. One of them is this. It's actually a Region 1 European thing, Youngsters on the Air, YOTA, because those guys have got, I don't know if they've got all the answers, but they've done more than most in terms of getting young hams involved. And the other is this Collegiate Amateur Radio group on Facebook is a good place to go and interact with young people who are getting into ham radio, because they could use the support of us old timers. So Brennan Price and New Frontiers in Wireless. Well, at the time of the talk, Brennan was the chief technology officer at the ARRL. He'll tell you about what that job is all about at the beginning of the talk, but mostly it focuses on either trying to get new spectrum for amateur radio or protect the spectrum that we've got, mostly at the ITU and the World Radio conferences, WRC conferences. Since the DCC, Brennan has left the ARRL and he's joined these folks here, EchoStar. He is the senior principal engineer on their regulatory affairs team. He said his duties include ITU, regional and domestic regulatory and advocacy work. In other words, pretty much all the stuff he's been doing with the ARRL. Brennan has appeared on Ham Radio Now a few times, three times, always talking about the WRC and the international regulatory stuff. He was way back in episode 6, and Cliff and I actually headed up to Washington, D.C., and set up the cameras and did an interview in person. He was also in episode 131. This is just before WRC 15, when there was a possibility of getting a 60-meter ham band. And then talked to him again in episode 240 after that WRC and the relatively disappointing result for 60 meters. And well, the reason for the let's go Dutch is the folks in Holland said, screw the WRC. We're giving everybody, I think, that 200 kilohertz ham band on 100 watts. The WRC proposed 15 kilohertz wide and just a handful of watts. Okay, so if you want to see the kind of stuff Brennan had done before, then stop back at those episodes. This talk will cover the opportunities and challenges of using the spectrum that most of us, I suppose, will never actually touch, including our 200 megahertz wide allocation, 200 megahertz wide allocation at 47 gigahertz. Let me check something here. It's my Baofeng tri-band handy talkie. 47 gigahertz. Nope, it's got 2 meters, 220, 440. No 47 gigahertz there. Maybe some of you will end up using that spectrum. You know, some of the five and dime stuff that Michelle W5NYV and Bob in NY4H had talked about for that geosynchronous satellite, or maybe the 5 gigahertz stuff that Brian W9CA described for his HamWAN system, or maybe the Arden network. They use spectrum at 2.4, 3.4, 5.9 gigahertz. Andre gave a talk at K6AH and described that. So maybe some of you will actually end up using that spectrum. Not with this. I don't know. Maybe something like it. Maybe Sterling and Marty will end up there. But whether we end up there or not, we should at least understand what this is all about. So Brennan's talk is about half of this program. The second half is some particularly interesting Q&A. So I recommend checking out the whole thing. Let's head back to St. Petersburg, where we are just finishing dessert. This is the banquet talk on Saturday night. And Steve Bible will introduce Brennan.
So we've come to that point in the conference where we have been anxiously awaiting to hear from our distinguished guest. And this is where, you know, I never did get your cut down bio.
That's because I never gave you my cut down bio.
Okay, so the cut down bio is everyone, Brennan Price, everyone. And Brennan's a lawyer. And probably one of the little known things you know about Brennan Price is he is a chess champion. Well, he probably won't admit that he's a champion, but he's very much a chess aficionado. Okay, how's that? He's a chess aficionado. So therefore, beware if you want to play a game of chess with Brennan. He's a chemical engineer of all things, okay? And I just learned by our conversation here at the table that the reason why he got his ham radio license, he wanted to know more about how the broadcast equipment worked when you worked at a broadcast station. So I take it that he probably did not succeed, right? So ham radio is a lot different than broadcast, but we're still nonetheless. So he works on a master's degree for chemistry and then decides that he doesn't want to go to school anymore, and then he becomes a lawyer. Where's John Ackerman when we need a lawyer joke, right? Okay. So what's fascinating about amateur radio is the people. And there's the fascination, of course, with DCC is all the different walks of life that are here. So there are lawyers, there are engineers, there are doctors, there's just all sorts of people, and that's what makes amateur radio so colorful. So really enjoy having you all here. I hope you've had an opportunity to meet and greet, and most importantly, exchange ideas. Okay, that is our number one reason for holding the Digital Communications Conference. And we have the published proceeding so that it's held for prosperity, okay? And a copy goes into the Library of Congress, okay? So that, you know, the future researchers 1,000 years from now will see that grand ideas were incubated at the DCCs, okay? So, at least that's what I would like to think, right? So congratulate yourselves for the ideas, the papers that you have written, the talks that you have given, and we encourage you to keep at it. So to help us be motivated, Brennan has an exciting talk for us here to help us gauge what the future is going to be like. So I'd like to welcome and big round of applause to Brennan Price, N4QX.
Thank you, Steve, for the introduction. Thank you, everyone, for attending tonight. It is a pleasure to be here. I've not been able to be at a TAPR DCC since you were in Baltimore a few years ago because the scheduling was not conducive with my obligations overseas. I feel like I've been away too long from a group that's doing very important and very exciting stuff, and I am very pleased to be back. So my title at ARRL is Chief Technology Officer. This despite the fact that by academic training I am a chemist, by professional training I'm a lawyer. This is my second tenure at ARRL. I have been in this position for 8 years with a CTO title for about 6 years and 9 months. Prior to this tenure, I had another tenure around 2000 as a field and regulatory correspondent where I would answer regulatory questions and help prepare cases to go before Riley Hollingsworth that our OOs were working on. I was then product review editor for about 15 months before I decided I wanted to concentrate on law school. So how does someone become a chief technology officer, and perhaps more importantly, what does the CTO of ARRL do? Most of the calls that I get from the membership or inquiries from outside the organization are pitches like, hey, you're the CTO, we want you to know about our membership management software package, or our latest server solution, which will help you move everything to the cloud and so forth. That is not what I do. No. I politely refer pitches on the latest hardware and software platforms to Mike Keen, who is in our Newington headquarters, who manages our IT effort. So this I do not do. What does the ARRL CTO do? Well, the chief technology officer is responsible for advising the CEO and the board on matters relating to the encouragement and use of new technologies in the amateur services. And I assist the president and the CEO on representing the league to federal government agencies and international organizations on technical issues. That last sentence is a very demanding process and probably accounts for at least 80% of how I spend my time preparing for meetings that lead up to and eventually culminate in the World Radio Communication Conference that happens every 4 years or so. So that portion of my job is illustrated here. This is a highly simplified flowchart of what I do for a living. That always gets laughs. I'm not joking. This really is a highly simplified flowchart of what I do for a living. One of the things about speaking to this particular audience is that I'm really preaching to the choir here. When we announced that I would be speaking here after Steve generously extended the invitation and I accepted, on the ARRL website, I said, I'm going to be discussing developments in various fields, including 5G mobile, wireless, the Internet of Things, intelligent transportation systems, and I'll discuss how these offer opportunities to technically inclined radio amateurs while also presenting spectrum defense challenges. And I'll test on domestic and international aspects. And I'm going to do that, but I hope I don't bore you to death because you've already had two Internet of Things presentations, and these were presentations by folks who are actually doing things with the Internet of Things. Bob and Michelle are going to be talking about spectrum tomorrow. They talked about the microwaves today. This audience tonight gets the necessity of pushing boundaries in order for amateur radio to remain relevant. And I'm very grateful for that. And what I hope I will inspire you to do tonight is to take what I'm preaching tonight and preach it elsewhere, because we need more of you. The challenges are real. This is not designed to be an eye test. If you really want to see some of the items, stepping back for a moment, if we go up two slides to, I hope they'll let me go back two slides. There we go. I'm not going to go through this flowchart for everything that's on the slide that you just saw. The goal of tonight's talk is not to give you an in-detail briefing on the various issues that are facing amateur radio. I put items up from the 2019 WRC agenda in order to give an idea of some of the things that are happening out there that countries around the world feel are significant enough to spend time and effort on as they consider amendments to the international radio regulations. The amateur service is something that countries consider at the ITU level. The first item up here is considering an allocation of 54 megahertz to the amateur service in Region 1. And as a matter of fact, it's the first item on the agenda, 1.1. So I'll talk a little bit more about that toward the end of the talk, but amateur radio is an asset that is considered at the international level, and we shouldn't lose sight of that. But for the one thing up top, where we are kind of on the offense, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 issues where there are some significant spectrum defense challenges that could be posed depending on how these issues develop. The issues include the accommodation of small satellites, CubeSats essentially, various issues related to transportation systems, ITS in general, and specifically railway communications. There will be consideration of a number of millimeter wave bands for the fifth generation of mobile broadband, IMT. And that's something that I'll talk about a little bit later on. There are the boundary line between what is radio and what is light is probably going to get pushed up between from 275 to potentially up to 450 gigahertz. That's something which we'll have to work around. And finally, the 5 gigahertz band is something that's under a particular amount of pressure, not only from broadband RLANs, but also from certain intelligent transport systems applications. So these are the issues. I don't expect you to be able to read them. This PowerPoint presentation will be available on my LinkedIn page after tonight if you are interested in the nitty-gritty of what's up here. But let's just talk about some of these issues and how they are challenging and how they may offer some opportunities. So the millimeter waves are something that have attracted a lot of attention, both in the amateur and the popular press recently. If you read the September 2016 editorial in QST, our CEO Tom Gallagher was very generous in sharing my thoughts on some challenges we face on the 47 gigahertz band in particular. And this is due in part to work by one of our own and the professional work of a radio amateur. We have, for years, managed to use our millimeter wave allocations for impressive feats from hilltops. And we still do. There's a new U.S. to Canada distance record achieved on June 30th by four amateurs, two on the U.S. side, two on the Canadian side. So point-to-point communications on the millimeter waves are known, are impressive, are hard to achieve, are worthwhile, but are somewhat old. Several players in the mobile industry have funded work by a number of individuals, notably Ted Rappaport at 9NB and his team at NYU, to develop systems that would permit more than the simple point-to-point links that we use at 47 gigahertz. And these systems largely dealing with or utilizing adaptable beams, essentially boards that have antennas that point in different directions, and you can choose which one that you want at any given time. And at 47 gigahertz, the antenna doesn't have to be that big, so you can have several of them on the board. So between the development of adaptable beams and new understandings of millimeter wave propagations, point to multi-point usage of the millimeter waves band, millimeter wave bands, sorry, can't talk tonight, is becoming more normal than we previously thought that it was. And this is potentially disruptive because it's precisely this point to multi-point transmission that is the backbone of commercial wireless. And some EU countries are salivating over the fact that 47 gigahertz is right in the sweet spot of where they anticipate 5G wireless is going to be deployed. And it makes sense that it would be deployed in the millimeter waves as you go further up in frequency. The ability to accommodate wider signals and higher throughputs is substantially increased. So despite the dozens of gigahertz that are already allocated to the mobile service in the millimeter waves, there are a few countries out there who would like to utilize our puny little 200 megahertz. The only primary allocation we have between 24.05 gigahertz and 77.5 gigahertz for mobile broadband. So it's incumbent on us to resist that. We have actually resisted that somewhat on the domestic level. And I pay tribute to Ted for being an ally on this. The FCC recently identified a number of bands to consider for 5G mobile wireless. They were going to consider all of the bands that were put on the table at last WRC for consideration at next WRC. 47 gigahertz, our band, is off the table. And that's something for which Chris Imlay and I sweated a lot. Ted has also been a very passionate and public advocate that the amateur allocation there is a vital test bed for those of us who want to experiment in the future. So we've dodged a bullet domestically. We've not cleared that bullet internationally yet. Let's talk about the Internet of Things, moving things and stationary things. Scotty indicated earlier today, interconnection in the Internet of Things is almost universally wireless because it's easy. All those devices have to go somewhere in the radio or in the electromagnetic spectrum, but where will they? The Internet of Things doesn't necessarily deal with stationary things. Intelligent transport systems is a concept which encompasses radio location in some instances, the communication of data to roadside sensors or between vehicles in other instances. Both ITS and radio local area networks are looking at 5 gigahertz for expansion. It's hard to tell which one is a potential better sharing partner in a band that really isn't ours to begin with. One of the challenges that I have that has caused me to lose my hair over the last 8 years, I had a lot more hair when I started, is trying to defend bands that aren't really ours to begin with. Everywhere in the world between 440 megahertz and 24 gigahertz, all amateur allocations are secondary. And your only amateurs are only primary in region one from 430 to 440. So, here in the United States, we have to go down to 225 megahertz in order to find that lowest or that limit where we have a primary band. The thing about being a secondary service is that you can make plans and you can try to work around other services that are there. But at the end of the day, if more primary services are introduced into a particular band, you have to wonder how valuable that secondary allocation is at all. So we essentially do what we can. We remind people that we're there, we have investment there, and that we would like to be considered in the compatibility equation. The thing about intelligent transport systems that is potentially concerning is that there's a potential issue of safety of navigation and safety of life. And those issues elevate a particular application and give it a higher degree of protection. One of the difficulties that we had at a couple of cycles ago when we tried to gain an allocation at what was originally 500 kilohertz and ended up being 472 to 479 is that even though nobody makes distress calls at 500 kilohertz anymore, that was still something that mariners could do, and the argument was made, why are amateurs secondary on something where there is a safety of life concern? So ITS is a little bit scary. RLANs are also a little bit scary because they're ubiquitous. And the trick with RLANs is achieving appropriate mitigation techniques with cognitive systems in order to protect the primary occupants there, sometimes military radio location, sometimes other services. The expansion of RLANs at 5 gigahertz has been slow in the United States, in large part because of concerns by the defense industry and our armed forces. But they're under just as much pressure as we are. And sometimes sharing a band with the military is a good thing, as long as the military holds up. They're worried, candidly, about whether they'll be able to hold up at 5 gigahertz, at least throughout the whole band. Perhaps some segments will be better than others. Speaking of RLAN mitigation techniques, I've developed and perfected the ultimate one, which is a cable from the computer to the port. This is actually the desk at the main conference room in the ITU. So, anyway, moving forward. I want to talk a little bit about small amateur radio satellites and whether they are victims of their own success. Radio amateurs were the ones who proved the small satellite concept. CubeSats, by any definition, have been a disruptive, revolutionary, and highly successful development. They provide the ability of previously non-spacefaring nations to launch spacecraft. They provide the opportunity for radio amateurs to economically launch spacecraft. They provide the opportunity for anyone who wants to economically launch spacecraft to do so. So amateurs prove the concept, and non-amateurs who were interested in satellites but wouldn't know frequency management from a hole in the ground borrowed the concept lock, stock, and barrel, including the frequencies that the amateurs originally used. So that's an issue which we've been dealing with for a while. We've been trying to accommodate things that are reasonably amateur in nature. There's a realization, though, that this is untenable in the long term, and international efforts are underway to improve the situation, both on the education front and on the allocation front. On the allocation front, WRC 19 is considering an item for additional spectrum for telemetry, telecommand, and control of small satellites. At one point during the deliberations last November, the amateur 2-meter band and 70-centimeter band were under consideration for this purpose. It took a lot of hard work by a lot of people, but it turned out by Thanksgiving morning in Geneva, we were successful in excluding 2 meters and 70 centimeters from consideration in this item. They're looking at essentially 150 to 174 megahertz and 400.15 to 420. Sometimes the most satisfying results are the battles that you avoid. Had we had to fight this battle at the next WRC, it would have required a lot more resources than are required for the issues that we have. CubeSats are going to stay around. If the volume of CubeSats being launched increased by an order of magnitude, I borrowed this slide from a presentation I made about a year ago to the National Science Foundation. If that happened, and if amateurs followed suit and we had active amateur satellites, we would probably have to reconsider our voluntary terrestrial and satellite division within the amateur allocations. And our ability to accommodate non-amateur projects that are kind of sciency in the amateur satellite allocations would become proportionately more untenable. Finding a solution that does not rely on the amateur satellites allocations is a goal that IRU supports, and it's something which we think we're going to be able to get done in 2019. It's unclear to us that small satellites have to continue to use VHF and UHF for these purposes exclusively. The WRC 19 agenda item suggests that for unspecified technical reasons, small satellites have to use these bands. Well, you know, it is a new concept that we develop regulations for satellites based on their mass or their size. It seems to us that each particular satellite ought to be classified within a service depending on the nature of the transmissions, and then you choose an appropriate frequency and gain appropriate licensure if necessary for that service. It's not clear that a CubeSat can't operate in the microwaves or elsewhere as opposed to having VHF and UHF be vital. There are existing space operations allocations throughout the radio spectrum that usually overlap terrestrial, fixed, and mobile. Suitability of a particular band for a particular purpose is probably going to depend both on the use for space operations, telemetry, telecommand, control, and the terrestrial service use in the area around the Earth station. The answer is not simple. It will vary from case to case, but it is an answer that we need to think about. So, I've talked about some of these challenges. Are these bad things? No! These are not bad things. These are good things, because they don't necessarily need to, while these technologies are disruptive, they don't necessarily have to be disruptive to our detriment. The terms of an amateur radio license are quite generous in the United States. They generally are around the world as well. These things that people are doing in other fields and in industry are things that we can do as radio amateurs. Spectrum is a resource. It is a resource regardless of who uses it. There is no reason that we can't utilize disruptive technologies for the good of amateur radio and for the good of society. Automatic control of an amateur station sending a RIDI or data transmission is universally permitted in the United States at 50 megahertz or above. That opens up a lot of possibilities, and the potential uses for an amateur radio license are only limited by one's imagination. There's no reason at all why amateurs can't work with new and disruptive technologies within our allocations, particularly at VHF and above. And in fact, the leadership of IRU Region 1 is developing a standard for something they're calling the HamNet of Things, in order to support the effort to internationally harmonize the 50 to 54 megahertz allocation. For a variety of reasons that are unique to Europe, the system of extensive repeaters that we have developed here in the Americas simply is not going to fly over there. So they're working on an alternate justification for those upper two megahertz between 52 and 54. And this is the direction in which we're going, and it's a direction that I candidly applaud. So in summary, there are scary things out there. The pressures on our bands have existed ever since World War I, when the government realized that radio was actually very useful and they weren't going to let us back on the air. And it was ARRL's efforts in the early days that got us back on the air and kept amateur radio going. Our secondary footholds in the microwaves face ever-increasing pressures. They are difficult to defend because they are not really ours. Our small primary footholds at the millimeter wave waves there's an F there. Face new pressures as technology advances. But the scary things do not have to be scary, because we can do them and we can manage them. It is safer for us to use disruptive technologies in our bands than it is for others to do so. And Spectrum is fungible, it is useful. It is useful whether we use it or it is useful whether other people use it. So it is imperative on us to make sure that we're carrying our weight. We support radio amateurs who push the boundaries of our comfort zone, both in what amateurs do and where they do it. and you may count on ARRL defending the rights of amateurs who wish to do so. It is an absolutely imperative part of our mission to promote and advance the art, science, and enjoyment of amateur radio. ARRL could not do all of the things it does, both on the technology front, the operational front, the recreational front, without 160,000 plus members doing their part and paying into the cause every year. If you have done so, thank you. We appreciate it. If you have not done so, I invite you to join us, and I hope I'll have some opportunities to answer questions in the coming minutes and convince you to do that. Thank you. 73.
Any questions?
Okay. Certainly.
When I say we, I mean the disruptive people.
Okay.
What would you like us to do?
To disrupt.
What's your request for the disruption?
That's a significant question, and I would preface it by saying that my answer should not be construed as limiting. More disruption is better. The work that you and Dr. McGuire have been doing toward the GSO satellite that we hope to have over the Americas is certainly falls into that category. And it is something that I personally am very grateful for. Things like establishing our own ham net of things so that we don't get, so that we can have a foothold in that next big thing are things we should think about. I would like for radio amateurs to learn about adaptable beams, the type of antennas that Dr. Rappaport has been developing at NYU, and utilize them on the millimeter waves. There is little reason why relatively small amateur networks can't be established in cities on, say, the 47 gigahertz band, while at the same time, point-to-point communications can't occur out in the hills. We have a lot of capability and a lot of capacity, and we have to figure out ways to use it. And there are very few rules written about how we can use it. So those are a few things. Bob, you had your hand up.
So 47 gigahertz was, I think, successfully defended by HID because of the size of the antennas to make the timing of the beams. So just to tell you how valuable, and I want to know what trouble we might be in at 73 gigahertz. And the reason for that is, Ted recently did an experiment on the back porch of his house where he sent 1 gigabit per second 10 miles, 73 gigahertz.
Yeah.
So he was able to send over a gigahertz wide signal 10 miles and close the link on 1 gigabit per second. So 73 gigahertz is where they're going. Was that under threat at all in IRU, or is Ted's work too new?
66 through 86 gigahertz is a range which is under consideration in large part for next generation broadband in 2019. That being said, the amateur foothold there is essentially from 77 to 81 gigahertz, perhaps 76 to 77 if you're in Europe. We have a pretty good sharing partner there, thanks to some work at the last WRC in short-range automotive radar. And while the FCC said some discouraging things in the domestic proceeding, which is still ongoing, seeking to implement short-range radar within that band, we believe we've very successfully rebutted it, and we've made a very good compatibility case, candidly working very closely with radio location interests, particularly Robert Bosch, who's a manufacturer of automotive radars. Essentially, point-to-point communications from mountaintops work very well with short-range radars at ground level. And I believe there's a relatively good case to be made based on, because of the radar manufacturer's ability to make sure that other radars don't interfere with another car's radar operating on the same band, that we'll be able to do some point-to-multipoint work there as well. The area around the amateur allocation is under a lot of pressure. The radar band is not being specifically considered for 5G wireless, and we think that we've come to a good solution there. We hope the FCC agrees with us.
So, I'm going for it.
No, I'm
going for it. ladies,
we fight all the time.
Ladies first, Bob.
Go ahead. He can go first.
Thank you. Okay, so part of the reason that schools, et cetera, want to use the amateur allocations at 2 and 70 centimeters for CubeSats will go away if you move them very far. Part of the reason is the inexpensive cost of our hardware for their purposes. If you have to go large-scale commodity pricing to small-scale expensive pricing, the world will rebel against the CubeSats moving far. So the solution has to be nearby.
That is the best explanation of the unspecified technical reason for being nearby. They should hire you for their advocacy at the ITU. And I should point out that educational projects at schools that provide an opportunity for amateurs to participate in a meaningful way do exist and fall within the instructional exception, which is so valuable in our pecuniary interest prohibited transmission rules. ARRL supports initiatives like that. The FCC, I think, in an overreaction to candidly, some abuses for outside the academic arena. It has been a little bit skeptical of these types of operations and has been licensing a lot of these as experimental. They're entitled to do that. That's not what we would like to have happen in the long run. We continue the fight. We'll work on it.
One of the things I've kind of learned the hard way is if we're kind of a room of purists here, and we have pretty much a harmonized agenda, but you've seen firsthand that this is really a very, very hardcore compromise environment. Can you speak a little bit to the process of the compromise at your level, that you, the visibility that you have?
I want to share a story that I shared with Steve earlier this evening. It was late about 2 years ago, about 8 o'clock at night during the next to last day of a meeting in Geneva. We were talking about the 4G wireless issue at the last WRC at a preparatory meeting, and proceedings had come to a standstill and people were taking a break, having coffee and having discussions in the halls. And I was sitting among the United States delegation and somebody from the Coast Guard was pontificating with some other of his friends from various DOD branches. And he stopped and he turned to me and he said, "Why are people afraid of you?" And I said, and by you, he meant in part me, but he also meant in part my people. I said, "We have passion." And he retorted, "We have guns." And I reminded him, well, some of us have guns, too. There are 750,000, more or less, licensed radio amateurs in the United States, and a broad spectrum, pardon the pun, of interests. The purists in this room may have different interests than the people who are enthused by traditional modes of communication, and I don't denigrate that population because I am among them. Morse code is approximately 99% of what I do on the air, and it's because it's simple, it's accessible, it fits within my schedule, and it's worthwhile. It is our job to represent amateur radio in all of its forms. I want people to transmit in Morse if they want to transmit in Morse. I want people to use disruptive technologies if they want to use disruptive technologies. I want people who have amateur radio licenses for no other reason than to use a few channels on 50 megahertz to have more flexibility to fly their model airplanes. I want them to be accommodated too. All of these people, however, have passion, and people tend to have passion for their preferred operating interest. I would advise all amateurs to, when thinking about doing new things or how to accommodate new things, to step back, realize the world didn't come to end when Spark transitioned to CW, realize the world didn't come to end when people started transmitting on AM in the amateur band above 1500 kilohertz. Realize the world didn't come to an end when AM got largely displaced for single sideband for efficiency reasons. I understand passion for a preferred operating mechanism. And I give credit to people who think about how to accommodate all of these mechanisms. And there are a variety of ways to do so. But what I do not understand, and what the league will resist, candidly, is the assertion that we ought not to do anything new because it hurts the ability to use legacy mode X, Y, Z, or W, or perhaps even new revolutionary mode X, Y, Z, or W. We have to share the sandbox, and you know, it is difficult. It is particularly difficult because you have 750,000 people who are very passionate and will file comments in any proceeding that might come up. If you compare ourselves to the mobile wireless industry or the satellite industry, those industries have a handful of major players. And you can expect those major players and some consumer advocacy groups and perhaps a few interested people to comment with any particular proceeding. And there may be 100 or so comments filed, and the person looks at them and moves on. You will get thousands of comments in an amateur proceeding of varying opinions and varying quality, sometimes expressing opinions in the same set of comments that are not reconcilable with one another. That makes the landscape a little bit more challenging. But we must try, and try we do.
Getting back to the CubeSat frequency allocation problem, I suppose there probably are international restrictions on doing this, but it seems to me there's a chunk of spectrum from 220 to 222 that UPS isn't using anymore.
The 220 to 222 issue happened before my time. It was ugly. I have read enough about it to know that it's ugly. Candidly, 220 through 222 is probably going to be used in the long term to solve the train issue that was on the iChart slide that I put up. I wish I could be more optimistic there. I'm afraid I can't. I would like to, the impediment to using that particular band, the broader band between 220 and 225 for a satellite service is that it is only allocated within ITU Region 2. One of the reasons, that's the same reason why there's no satellite allocation at 50 megahertz. I would hope that to the extent that we are successful achieving a harmonized 50 megahertz allocation in 2019, I would hope that we would be able to get on the 2023 agenda a potential amateur satellite allocation. We were not able to include that factor on the agenda in this conference because it was just viewed as being too complicated, which is unfortunate.
The low VHF television spectrum and most of the high VHF television spectrum is on Cal. What are you going to do with that?
Well, that's our argument in Europe, and we hope that we'll be able to grab 4 megahertz of it so we can have a worldwide harmonized band. While it has gone considerably more fallow than it used to be, at least here in the States, it's not completely dead. There are a few legacy translators out there that make a 70 megahertz band somewhat of a pipe dream. I also anticipate that the commercial pressures on that band in the long term will be very difficult to overcome. I get more questions about 70 megahertz than I do about any other band. And if we had viewed that as an achievable goal, we would have pursued that by now. But it's something that I think is going to be decades away, candidly.
There's a lot of spectrum there. That's just kind of looking at it off the hands. Will that take pressure off of any other spectrum? Is it valuable spectrum? Does anybody want it?
I believe the consensus is that it is valuable. How quickly and when people move into there, I don't know. I'm sorry, I wish I had a better answer for you. Sir?
Do you know anything about the low frequency, the 136 and the 462? Is that going to happen?
More and more countries have implemented that without any issues. We have a number of radio amateurs who hold experimental licenses within that band. We have made the argument to the FCC in response to the notice of proposed rulemaking. We believe we have a winning argument. But we are at the stage where the commission is deliberating. They will deliberate for as long as they jolly well please. And the prediction of an outcome is dangerous. You cannot tell what the outcome will be or when it will occur until it actually occurs. I do know that we've put forward a very solid argument. I do know that the world has demonstrated that it is feasible. We should gain those allocations. And if the commission doesn't give them to us, they are wrong. Sir?
Yeah, to carry on. Gary was just saying there's been a lot of discussion about unused television stations, and especially commercially using what we call white space technology.
Yes.
With unused television channels. What do you know about that? And then secondly, does white space technology radio?
With respect to white space technologies, that is one of the, that's the primary reason why organized amateur radio hasn't seen fit to attempt to gain a foothold within the low VHF spectrum. And you said, what about white space where? Affecting ham radio? The proponents of using white space for commercial purposes seem to be very focused on the TV bands. The only band that has essentially been pointed at by somebody somewhere in the world where they've shamelessly said, we want right now is 47 gigahertz. I also include 5 gigahertz in that, except 5 gigahertz is secondary. It's not really ours to begin with. you know, than con. Yes.
Might it make sense for us to have some sort of a white space authorization in, written into Part 97 to allow us to go do things in those television channels that are not being used?
That is certainly within the realm of possibility, and I would encourage you to write whomever your division director is to promote that policy.
Will they be Part 15 or not?
It would be whatever the rule makers say they are. That's the cool thing about being a regulator. You can.
What's the status of the civil rate proposal?
It is subject to notice of proposed rulemaking. The comment deadline is October 11th. The reply comment deadline is November 10th, because it's 30 days and October has 31 days. I do know that the FCC proposed only part of what ARRL had proposed. They did propose to remove the symbol rate restrictions, but declined to propose a maximum bandwidth. The reason why ARRL proposed the maximum bandwidth to begin with is because that is the bandwidth toward which these technologies are developed because of international regulations for other services, namely the maritime services. So we felt that was reasonable. We realize that other folks have different opinions. The FCC said, no, we don't really want to deal with this. I do know that other folks would like to see some segregation of wideband digital to a certain part of the data segment. I mentioned Ted Rappaport earlier. I very much admire his work on 47 gigahertz. I give him credit, even though he's proposing a solution which is different than what the League has proposed in the past. I give him credit for trying to offer a solution which would allow wideband communications to take place somewhere in the band, even if it's not how the League decided to go in the past. I don't know how ARRL is going to decide to file comments in the future. That's up to our executive committee, and they're considering what to do before the October 11th comment deadline. So this is obviously something which has stoked the passion of a lot of radio amateurs. I urge you to think about it and file comments as you see fit. There are essentially three ways to approach it. You either don't have a limit of any type, you limit wideband digital to certain frequencies, or you limit it to a certain maximum bandwidth. Those are three ways you can possibly accommodate things. The fourth way is no change, and that is not something that with which I am comfortable and the League is comfortable, candidly. It is difficult to argue that amateur radio is a technically progressive radio service that advances the state of the art when we cannot even approach the state of the art in HF data communications. And right now, we cannot even approach that state of the art. So,
the innovation in many areas is related to demographics. So you need, especially looking around this room, I think we need to address demographics. What does the ARRL currently think about the demographics, and what do you know about it?
We know and acknowledge that the demographics are an issue. In fact, our CEO, Tom Gallagher, identified our aging demographics as a threat that has the potential to be existential. So this is something which we realize and are making efforts to address. Ever since Tom came on board, he has been very focused on expanding our educational initiatives, developing new curricula, and finding new ways to reach out to people who are much younger than us, and I'm very grateful for his efforts on that front and the efforts of other folks on staff in Newington. What appeals to today's young person, today's student, is probably not the same thing that appealed to us when we got into amateur radio. And I got into amateur radio relatively recently, 1997. I've been doing this for 19 years now. And even since 1997, the world of telecommunications has changed drastically. The novelty of being able to communicate without infrastructure to someone halfway around the world is, it has some appeal, but it will not be a universal appeal. And I think we have to recognize that. And I think a lot of the things that you're doing hold the possibility of having broader appeal. It's not some, amateur radio is not something that is going to appeal to everyone. And we don't have to be something that appeals to everyone, but we've got to do something because, you know, I'm age 45 and I'm the second youngest person in the ARRL boardroom. I appreciate your time. Thank you.
So what I'd like to do is on behalf of the ARRL and TAPR DCC, I'd like to present to you a plaque, and we'd like to thank you, Brennan, for being our keynote speaker at the conference today. So I hope you...